standing committees. I now request Sri Naresh Gujralji to kindly interact with honourable members on the importance of question hour. Gujral sir.
Good afternoon, my friends and colleagues. It's both a privilege and a pleasure to be with you this afternoon. In fact, many of you, I'm sure, have been legislators before in state assemblies, so you are aware of the importance of question hour. But since I've been asked to speak, I'll be repetitive. First of all, I must say this is a very pleasant surprise because I belong to a small party in Parliament. So in my last 14 years in Parliament, the maximum time that I've ever been granted is 8 minutes to speak. So when I was told that I could speak for 45 minutes, I said, what will I say? Because now one is so used to compressing one's speeches that to elongate it is quite a challenge. However, anyway, I will, apart from the rules and regulations, I'm sure you're quite familiar with them, I will also share my experiences, which in certain cases have been quite funny also. We all know that Parliament is the highest accountability forum of the country. And the question hour is primarily there to elicit information and to ensure accountability. And I can tell you one thing. In 14 years, I've seen, and my late father, Mr. I.K. Gujral, used to tell me, that this is 1 hour that all ministers dread because they are on test and their performance is being tested during question hour. I know of certain cases, including one cabinet minister, who used to land up at the homes of members in the morning, members who were asking questions, with a request that please absent yourself so that the question will not be taken up. And this became a joke in Parliament. And eventually, the chairman decided that if a member absents himself and the question has been listed, then it's the property of the House. So any member can then ask questions about it. So, but this is just to show how important it is and how ministers take it very seriously. And one ploy, you know, especially when you are asking a very sharp question, many times you may have noticed a minister will start his answer by first start trying to compliment you. Now, basically, he's trying to put you at ease so that you don't ask more sharp questions. And at the same time, gaining some time, he will say, "Bahut achha, aapne sawal pucha, iska bahut mahatv hai." But basically, he's waiting for the secretariat in the galleries to send him a quick slip so that he can then reply to your questions also. So don't get taken in by these kind of ploys. Also, I have seen in my past experience that you make your reputation or unmake a reputation through the question hour. Ministers have been dropped by many prime ministers because they were unable to, they might have been competent ministers, but they were not able to answer the questions properly. Similarly, reputations were made of MPs. There are legends like Firoz Gandhi, like Bhupesh Gupta, Nath Pai. I mean, I can name so many who basically Pilu Modi with humor, he would flatten a minister. And if you recall, just through questions, the mighty Nehru was challenged by his son-in-law, Firoz Gandhi, when he asked a question on the Mundra affair. And Mr. Nehru was quite incensed. But since the question was there, the government had to answer. The result was that the then Finance Minister, T.T. Krishnamachari, had to resign because he was able to unravel a scandal. I am also reminded of a time when Mrs. Indira Gandhi was Prime Minister. And if you, many of you would, who are familiar with the history of Congress politics would recall that at that time there were two groupings in Congress, the Indira Gandhi group and the so-called syndicate in which Mr. Morarji Desai was also the leading member. And Mr. Desai was also the finance minister. And I personally recollect a question was tabled that day in Parliament. And Mrs. Gandhi wanted her own minister to be embarrassed. So a slip was sent to Mr. Bhupesh Gupta at his house, which I personally delivered. I don't know the contents of it, but it was a sealed cover where certain information was provided, and Mr. Bhupesh Gupta then started grilling the finance minister, and of course Morarji Bhai was greatly embarrassed. So this is how, you know, one question can make or unmake a reputation. And I do remember people like Bhupesh Gupta, Pilu Modi, Firoz Gandhi, they were not ministers, but they were more powerful than the ministers because their requests were never turned down, because the ministers knew that if they go on their wrong side, they would face a lot of music in the house. So this is the strength of your questions in Parliament. I would also like to mention here the great parliamentarian Pilu Modi, who once said to, when Mrs. Gandhi was answering a question and she was getting quite irritated, and he said, "Madam, we are your loyal opposition. Your enemies are sitting behind you." So this is how humor also always helps in Parliament. One thing I would again tell you, and I'm sure you have so much experience about this, that answers by ministers have to be totally precise and accurate. And if the ministers are not giving you accurate answers, you have a right to persist, and you have a right to demand that your questions be answered clearly. And because if a minister does not answer them clearly, it can be construed as an attempt to mislead the House, which can lead to raising questions of privilege. And it's happened so many times in the past. Of course, whether it is question of privilege or not, it's the chair that decides whether it's a question of privilege or not. It goes to the chairman, but it does happen from time to time. One thing I would say, whatever is the provocation, and this happens so many times, I would urge all members, do not enter the well of the House, because this actually had become a practice in the past. And I can tell you, I'm a chartered accountant by training, so I resort to figures. I've been in the House now almost 14 years. Parliament meets three times a year, roughly 4 or 5 weeks in a year, which means say about 90 days in a year. You remove Saturdays, Sundays, public holidays, it comes to 50 to 55 days in total. Now, in my experience, I must have attended 700 to 725 days when question hours were there. But unfortunately, of those, at least one third of the time, there was disruption, so question hour was done away with. So basically, I would say I may have seen 500 days, 525 days total of question hour days. And given the fact that so many questions are put by all the members, your turn comes very infrequently. Now, in my case, my turn may have come 20 to 25 times in these 14 years, maybe 30 times, but not more than that, and that is the average on the whole. So the best way is that you obviously want to be noticed, you also want to ask relevant questions. There are questions which are relevant for your constituency or your state. We are a council of states after all. So I would say that the best I saw in my own case, that the best thing to do is when you get the list in the morning, you go through the questions which are listed. And then you decide which are the questions which interest you and where you would like to ask questions. And you prepare yourselves for that. Now, again, something which the rule book will not tell you, you have to draw the attention of the chairman at that time or the deputy chairman, whoever is on the chair. Of course, you raise your hands, and most times many people raise their hands at the same time. So all the people cannot be asked. What I have discovered is that if a question has been asked and you wish to ask a question on the next one or a supplementary on the next question, you should try to catch the eye of the marshal and tell him next one. So at least your name goes up first. When your name goes up first, there's every chance that you will be able to ask your supplementary. I must tell you that today, because I was told by the secretariat earlier that certain members had questions regarding how are these questions chosen which are listed. When I entered Parliament, there were allegations of manipulation. There were certain influential members, so to say, who were managing to have their questions listed very frequently, and others were not getting their questions listed as frequently. But I must say, today it is totally transparent. They have a system which is computerized. Members are in a way invited to be there when they're picking out the questions. So from that viewpoint, I don't think anybody need have any fear. It's a totally transparent system. It all depends on how many questions you put in. And again, I would urge you, because again, it's been brought to my notice, that certain members are putting in a starred, same question, as starred and unstarred. Now, those will not be two questions. That will be clubbed as one question. So be careful in that. Whenever you are putting in a starred question, then don't put that also as unstarred. Because you're going to get your reply in any case. If it is not listed, it becomes an unstarred question. You will get your reply. And second, when you are putting in that form, please don't forget to sign it. Every single form has to be signed, otherwise it will come back to you. That's another point that you need to take note of. I can talk of admissibility, but have you circulated that to them, or should I just speak a little bit on this? Sorry? Yeah. Well, you all have the rule book, but I'll just mention about the admissibility of questions briefly. As per Rule 47, the following are the conditions of admissibility of a question. It should be pointed, specific, and confined to one issue only. It shall not bring in any name or statement not strictly necessary to make the question intelligible. If it contains a statement, the member shall make himself responsible for the accuracy of his statement. It shall not contain arguments, inferences, ironical expressions, imputations, or defamatory statements. It shall not ask for an expression of opinion or the solution of an abstract legal question of hypothetical proposition. It shall not ask as to the character or conduct of any person except in his official or public capacity. The question shall not exceed 100 words. It shall not relate to a matter which is not primarily the concern of the Government of India. It shall not ordinarily ask for information on matters which are under the consideration of a parliamentary committee. It shall not ask about proceedings in a parliamentary committee which have not been placed before the council by the report from the committee. It shall not reflect on the character or conduct of any person whose conduct can be challenged on a substantive motion. It shall not make or imply a charge of a personal character. It shall not raise questions of policy too large to be dealt within the limits of an answer to a question. It shall not repeat in substance questions already answered or to which an answer has been refused. It shall not ask for information on trivial matters. It shall not ordinarily seek information on matters of past history, it shall not require information set forth in accessible documents or in ordinary works of reference. It shall not raise matters under the control of bodies or persons not primarily responsible to the Government of India. It shall not ask for information on a matter which is under adjudication by a court of law having jurisdiction in any part of India. It shall not relate to a matter with which a minister is not officially connected. It shall not refer to discourtesy to a friendly foreign nation. It shall not seek information about matters which are in their nature secret. And here I am reminded of Winston Churchill, who had a unique way of answering questions, and in fact he would floor all the members when he would answer questions. In March 1943, a member asked for an undertaking that no answer to any Axis peace proposal shall be made until the House of Commons had an opportunity of expressing its opinion on them. Mr. Churchill replied, "An assurance of this kind would be contrary to constitutional usage, by which such issues are reserved to the Crown, acting on the advice of the ministers who themselves are responsible to Parliament for their conduct." So basically, anything which is secret in nature, which is of sensitive nature, the government is not obliged to answer that. As per Rule 48, in matters which are or have been a subject of correspondence between Government of India and the Government of a state, no question shall be asked except as to matters of fact, and the answer shall be confined to a statement of fact. Questions seeking information on matters falling within the exclusive domain of the states and for which state government is responsible are not admitted. However, when the state is under the President's rule, all questions pertaining to matters falling within the sphere of that state are admitted. Usually the following types of questions are admitted for written answers, that is, as unstarred questions: questions seeking information of statistical nature, questions seeking information in great detail, questions raising matters of local interest, questions relating to strength of staff in government offices of department and representation in the service of communities protected under the Constitution, and questions to which prima facie there could be no scope for supplementaries, questions asking for statements to be laid on the table, and questions of interest only to a limited section of the people. These, however, are only illustrative. One more thing I may mention, that if you are asking a question about a subject or on a subject in which you have some kind of direct or indirect interest, you must first get up and declare your interest and only then proceed with the question. Otherwise, it is not considered ethical. Since I talked of disruptions in the House, let me also tell you that when we feel that something very important is not coming up or must come up immediately, members ask for suspension of question hour. Now, if a member wishes to move a motion of suspension of Rule 38 relating to questions, he has to take recourse to Rule 267. However, such a motion can be moved only and only with the consent of the chairman, and the chairman's ruling on it is always final. And because we've had we were in the opposition, and we've seen then, we are again in the opposition now, so we see it again. But the main thing is that you cannot challenge the authority of the chairman on these matters. No point of order is generally permitted during question hour, unless there is clear violation of procedure or some extraordinary point. It has been held by the chairman that misleading answers or wrong answers do not give rise to a point of order. You can move a privilege motion, but they do not give rise to a point of order. When sittings of the House towards the end of the session are cancelled that is, the session is terminated earlier than scheduled, as may happen this time, those questions listed for those days, they lapse and they will come back to you. They will not automatically get relisted. Unless the chairman otherwise directs, a member is required to give not less than 15 days notice for a question. Interestingly, questions given by a member lapse on the expiry of the member's term, even if the member is re-elected and may be present in the House, but those questions lapse then. Thereafter, he has to give a fresh notice for those questions. You all know that there is a limit on the number of questions that you can put in, start and unstart. So basically, these are the salient features of the questionnaire, and I have found that that is the liveliest hour in Parliament, more so when there are, no, of course, with pandemic, the House has hardly a few members sitting in the Raj Sabha, others in the galleries and Lok Sabha. But now that we have resumed, that everybody is sitting in the Raj Sabha, you will see that from next session onwards, when all the members are present, this is the liveliest hour. And I would urge all of you to participate. And even if your names are not there, ask supplementaries. Keep the ministers on their toes, because that is the only way the government functions efficiently. Thank you very much. If you have any questions, I'd be very happy to answer.
Is there any restriction for asking questions in a session?